morning. I'm so glad to see all of you here. It's such an honor to have you all here. Some faces I haven't seen in a while, and some faces I've never met, and very pleased and honored to have you all here. My name is Pastor Braden. I'm the new pastor. I've been a pastor for about a month and a half, and so it's such an honor, again, just to see you all and meet you all, and thankful to be able to gather for Easter to celebrate our risen Savior. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So, a few announcements this morning. So, for anyone who is new, we have these beautiful Connect cards and prayer cards in the back of each pew. And if you're new here, and you want to stay up to date with what's been going on here at this church, what's going to be happening moving forward and things like that, just go ahead and put your information here on the back, and where it says Connect. And then on the other side, where it says prayer, it will be a good time for if you have a prayer request that you'd like us to be praying for, as I pray for these prayer requests in my office. And then if it's, we can also pray for it during the prayer meeting. If that's what you would like, you can mark that if you'd like that. You can fill it out here. And then as the as we do our offering, we pass our plates, you can drop those right in the plate, and we can get them, and we will be able to get connected to you, and you'll be connected to us. And so we're just so thankful to have you all here. Another thing coming up is next Sunday, we're going to begin our Sunday evening services. Sunday evening services will be right here in this main sanctuary. We're going to go back to a little bit of our roots and do a nice class on the five sola of the Reformation. And then we're going to study our doctrine statement, the 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith. Another thing that happens here every single week, but it happens in our fellowship hall, is our prayer meeting. And that is probably the most important thing we do at this church, is we gather together and we pray. That's the most important thing any of us can do in this time. And so I pray you join us for that, 7 p.m. on Wednesday nights. We have a little bit of teaching, fellowship, and a lot of prayer. So I pray you join us for that as well. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to invite our singers up to lead us in some worship and singing of spiritual songs and hymns. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you for this day. I thank you for the ability to gather. I thank you for the ability to be able to gather and sing, Lord, and celebrate that he is indeed risen. Lord, as we had a solemn Good Friday service to memorialize the death of Lord Jesus. But God, we just thank you that he indeed did rise from the dead. And we're going to talk about the implications of that moving forward. But God, hear our worship, hear our praise, and may it bring glory to you. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Hi, everybody. If you'd like to stand and sing with us, we're going to start with hymn 202, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
May be seated. Good morning. How are we doing today? I hope. How are we doing today?
Good.
I mean, this is Resurrection Sunday, so there should be life, correct? All right, we should be able to have some life in us when we are at church, especially on this day, for everything that this day represents and means to us and means to our faith and our hope and the promise. So Pastor Braden has asked me to come up and open up the scriptures and read the resurrection account from Luke chapter 24. So there's about 50 verses in there, so it'll be a moment. But what a wonderful story to take time to read, contemplate, and praise God for. Luke chapter 24. But very early on Sunday morning, the women went out to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance, and so they went in. But they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. And the men asked, I love this question, why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he had told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day? Then they remembered that he had said this, and so they rushed back from the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had just happened. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. But the story sounded like nonsense to the men, and so they didn't believe it. However, Peter jumped up and ran to the tomb to look. I mean, of course he did, right? It was Peter. Stooping in, he peered in and saw the empty linen wrappings. And then he went home again and wondered what had happened. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. And as they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened that day. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. And he asked them, what are you discussing so intently as you walk along? They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. And then one of them, Cleopas, said, you must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last few days. What things? Jesus asked. The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth, they said. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all of the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped that he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. This all happened 3 days ago. Then some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. And they said that his body was missing, and they had seen angels who told them that Jesus is alive. And some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. And then Jesus said to them, oh, you foolish people, you find it so hard to believe that all the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all of these things before entering his glory? And then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself. By this time, they were nearing Emmaus at the end of their journey. Jesus acted as if he were going on, but they begged him, stay the night with us since it is getting late. And so he went home with them, and as they sat down to eat, he took the bread and blessed it. And then he broke it, and he gave it to them. And suddenly their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. And they said to one another, didn't our hearts burn within us as we talked on the road, and he explained the scriptures to us? And within the hour, they were on their way back to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 disciples and the others who had gathered with them, and who said, the Lord has really risen. He just, as he appeared to Peter. Then the two from Emmaus told the story of how Jesus had appeared to them as they were walking along the road and how they had recognized him as he was breaking the bread. And just as they were telling about it, Jesus himself was suddenly standing there among them. "Peace be with you," he said. But the whole group was startled and frightened, thinking that they were seeing a ghost. "Why are you frightened?" he asked. "Why are your hearts filled with doubt? Look at my hands. Look at my feet. You can see that it's really me. Touch me and make sure that I am not a ghost, because ghosts don't have bodies as you see that I do." As he spoke, he showed them his hands and his feet. Still, they stood there in disbelief and filled with joy and wonder. And then he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he ate it as they watched. And then he said, "When I was with you before, I told you that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and in the Psalms must be fulfilled." And then he opened their minds to understand the scripture. And he said, "Yes, it is written long ago that the Messiah would suffer and die and rise from the dead on the third day. It was also written that this message would be proclaimed in the authority of his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. There is forgiveness of sins for all who repent. You are witnesses of all of these things. And now I will send the Holy Spirit, just as my Father promised. But stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with the power from heaven." Then Jesus led them to Bethany, and lifting his hands to heaven, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. So they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem filled with great joy. And they spent all of their time in the temple praising God. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you, Mr. Ross. If you guys would like to stand with us and sing, we're going to do hymn number 2, "Come Thou Fount."
Thank you.
I'd like to invite you all to open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 15. If you were here on Friday, it was a solemn time. It was a time of memorial. It was a time where it was very heavy, the service was in itself. It was a time where we looked at each other and we went through the service, and it was gloomy. As I got feedback from afterwards, and I heard some people, they said that was sad. That was really difficult to be part of, to listen to. And this is what I would say, is that day is sad. That day that we call Good Friday, the reason that it is good, the only reason that it would be good, is the result of it. The events of itself are very bad. So as we look, as we study, it was meant to be sad. It was meant to be heavy and gloomy. But if you were here, I made a promise. And that promise was that Sunday we would celebrate. And well, today is Sunday. And so we are celebrating because we serve a risen Savior. Amen. We serve a risen Savior who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who died for our sins, was buried, and then rose again on the third day, defeating death. I had Pastor Ross come up and read Luke 24 so we get an account of the story. Because today I would love to read and study what exactly happened. The testimony, the theological aspect behind the resurrection, behind the death of Christ. And so, as we look and as we study, we're going to dive into these things. We're going to really look at what does the resurrection of Christ mean for you and me. We pray for us, then we will begin. Heavenly Father, Lord God, Good Friday was hard. Good Friday was sad. Lord, but it is something we indeed do celebrate because we know that you handed over your Son as an offering to yourself that satisfied sins. God, and he was dead. He died a painful death, a horrible death. But God, we praise you for it. For we know this was the way that brought you the most glory. We know that this is the way in which you have ordained it to happen. But God, today we celebrate because we remember that our Lord is indeed risen. And Lord, as we pray, he sits at your right hand, ruling as sovereign. And we know that you will make his enemies his footstool. And then he will return. Lord, the day will come, the trumpet will sound, and we will be joyful. Lord, bless us as we study your word. Bless us as we dive into it. Bless us as we read it and grasp it. In your name we pray. Amen. We're in 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 and 2 says, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, in which you are being saved. And if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." Now let's stop right there, as our custom, as we like to go verse by verse through the scriptures. And we're taking a break from, we were in the book of Acts before, and for this special week, this holy week, leading up to Easter, we shifted. And we are looking at Luke's account, and now we are in 1 Corinthians. And the advantage of this is that we look at things verse by verse, we can understand what the text is teaching. This text is teaching us this. Paul wants to remind us of something, as the beginning of verse 1 says, "Now I remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you." And as we discuss this gospel, as we discuss what he preached to us. We remember, and Paul will go into this more, but in this quick summary, it's the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, which he will share again more. Which he says, which you received, meaning you believed in this. In other words, you trusted in this gospel I preached, and now you stand in it. When we think of the gospel, we must first associate that we must believe it. Then afterwards, we must stand in it. We must stand firm in this gospel. We must stand firm in the word preached to us in which we had believed. We must stand firm in it, not moving from it, not being thrown about by waves of unbelief and waves of pain, waves of sorrow, but standing firm in the gospel. And this gospel that we are being, that we're standing in, it is saving us. And the full completion of this salvation will come to fruition when Christ returns. But that is only true for us if we hold fast until the end. If we hold fast to it, we must endure, as the rest of Scripture would teach, as we are saved by grace through faith. But proof of genuine salvation is proved by perseverance. Which in all realities, we must say as well, as it's also perseverance, in other words, God is preserving us, allowing us to stand firm. But he says, if you do not stand in this, you've believed in vain. You've tricked yourself. You've not genuinely trusted the Lord Jesus. You've not been regenerated by the Holy Spirit. And so he's reminding us of importance. He's reminding us of this gospel. And he summarizes it in the next few verses. 1 Corinthians 15:3. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received. In other words, what he's about to share, and it's a very, very long sentence that we're about to see, is Paul likes to use these very long sentences. He says, I delivered this to you of first importance. In other words, this was the most important thing I shared with you. Out of all the things that I have shared with you in the past, this is of first importance. And always of first importance, Paul had received it previously himself. And this is something that as we analyze it, we look at it, I want you to ask yourself, have I received this gospel that is of first importance myself? This is our personal reflection as you sit in the pew. This is the time where we really look at ourselves and ask ourselves this question. Have I received as of first importance what the Apostle Paul and all other believers have also received? Have I genuinely trusted in this? And this is his first statement, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures. Let's break this statement down. It says that Christ died. Indeed, we know that Christ died. We just talked about it in depth on Friday. The depth of the pain, the depth of the sorrow in which he went through, the crucifixion that he endured, the horrible physical pain leading up to it, the torture, and then finally being nailed and hung upon the cross. And we indeed know this, that he indeed did die. Many have tried to say and attest and challenge the words of Scripture by saying that Christ did not die upon the cross. That your resurrection is him being merely being unconscious for a few days, or he faked his death and then woke up. But no, Paul says this specifically, Christ died. We cannot have a gospel if Christ did not die. We cannot have Sunday if Friday did not happen. Christ died. And why did he die? What was the reason that he died? For our sins. As we talked about previously, the pain, the physical pain of the cross. Now we must talk about what is really the most painful thing about the cross. And that was the for our sins part. Because these sins were paid for upon that cross, meaning this is how it happened. He took on the full wrath of God that God has against our sins. You and I have sinned against the holy God. We have defied his law. No matter how good of a person you think you are, you cannot do enough good things to work yourself to him, to amend that relationship that has been broken. Our forefather Adam, the first man created, and his wife, they sinned. And this sin nature is now passed down to us. We've inherited it from him. His sin and his sin nature. So therefore, we are stuck in sin. We stood condemned under the law of God, unable to follow it perfectly, unable to fulfill its requirements. So the response to this was that God sent his only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, both fully God and fully man, truly God and truly man, who lived a perfect life, fulfilling the law. Then he died upon a Roman cross. And while he was on that cross, God put our sins upon him. He poured his wrath out upon that cross, paying for our sins. The punishment that was due for you and I, for whoever would believe, has been put upon the shoulders of Christ. This was the most painful thing about the cross. It was upon his shoulders. A holy God separated from sin, sin being placed upon him. He hung there for 6 hours, but it would have been like multiple eternities. Eternities that are due for you and I if we do not put our faith in him, that we will pay for ourselves in hell. A very real place where God's presence is there, but it's only there to punish, not to bless. It's only there to judge and to punish. If you've trusted in the Lord Jesus, then your sins are upon his shoulders. You do not have to work anymore. All you have to do is surrender. He died for people from every tribe, nation, and tongue, every background, no matter what you've done. If you put your faith in the Lord Jesus, that he died for your sins, and you say, God, I'm not going to work myself, I'm not going to trust in myself, I'm going to trust in your Son, then you will be saved. There is no other way to salvation. You are not good enough, but Christ is. You cannot do enough good works, but the beautiful good news of the gospel is that Christ has already done all of the work. And so this is my call. If you've never trusted in him, surrender to him now. Surrender to the Lord Jesus. Trust in him as Savior. Don't look to yourself. Look to him. Look to the cross. It's a terrible and awful thing, but it is a beautiful thing. It is the only thing that we can look to and say how horrible it was, but yet how great it is. We see God's attributes all come together at the cross. We see his love, we see his mercy, we see his wrath. We most of all see his glory. For on that day, he defeated our sins. He crushed them. And we know that these things had to happen in accordance with the scriptures. Perhaps you might be wondering, well, Braden, in the Old Testament, per se, in these old Hebrew scriptures, where does it tell us that this would happen? Where does it tell us that Christ had to die? Where does it tell us that he had to die for our sins, specifically? I bring you to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53, 4 through 6, says this: surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We could go through that whole chapter and see where it is clearly pointing to the Lord Jesus, his life, his death, and then finally his resurrection, as it says that he will not remain in death, but he will rise again. As we look, as we study, the scroll of Isaiah was written over 500 years before the death of Christ. Now we could keep going through the Old Testament. We don't have time to today, and I could point to every instance where it talks about a suffering Savior who would rise from the dead. He died in accordance with scriptures. This is so convincing that those who would challenge this, who believe in the Hebrew scriptures and the Old Testament scriptures, they removed this chapter from it. From Isaiah, they removed it. They took out chapter 53 because it was too on point. It was too obvious that this is clearly pointing to Jesus of Nazareth. Now that's the sad part of this message. That's the sad part of this sermon. That's the hard part to listen to. The crucifixion and the death of our Lord. That's the difficult part. That's the part that when you listen to it, it makes you uncomfortable. That when I have to preach it, as though it is the gospel that brings us great joy, it burdens me and pains me to talk about the pain that our Lord endured upon the cross. But it is important that we believe it. It is important that we accept it. Because just as Friday happened, Sunday is now here. And Paul reminds us of that. Paul shares with us this, that he was buried. As he says in 1 Corinthians 15:4, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Remember, these things are of most importance. If the gospel just stopped at the cross, if Jesus just died and never rose again, we would still be dead in our sins and trespasses. We would still be lost. But Paul remembers that this is most important. It is the first thing, one of the first things we must see when we preach the gospel. We cannot just preach the cross and leave Jesus dead. When we preach the cross, we must also speak of his resurrection. That he was raised on the third day. Many would challenge this resurrection. Many would even challenge his burial. They would challenge his resurrection and say, well, his disciples simply went and stole his body. That's why it was not there anymore. Well, let me remind you. Let me tell you how this burial happened. The Pharisees specifically told the Roman guard and told the Roman authorities that there is a plan. They're going to try to steal his body. So you need to do everything you can to protect it. And so what they did is they rolled this giant stone in front of it. And not only did they roll this giant stone in front of it that took many men to put it there, what they did is they then take these ropes and they tie it across the tomb, tying it. And then in the middle, they put this giant wax seal, the seal of Caesar, that whoever would break this seal, let him be condemned. Words, to break the seal, to move this, is a terrible death. A death most likely by crucifixion. And if you break this seal, means you are defying Caesar himself. You are spitting in his face if you break this seal. You are claiming your authority is greater than his when you break this seal. And then on top of this, not only was there the seal there, they posted guards outside of the tomb. And so now these disciples, who are not trained warriors by any means, who are fishermen by trade and a tax collector and just kind of outcasts in society, some of them, then would have to basically go defeat these Roman centurions, these men that are greatly trained in the art of combat. That this has been their life, to be trained how to fight. And they're willing to die because they know that if they fail at what they've been tasked to do, For example, if a Roman guard was told to guard something and he was caught asleep or not at his post, they would execute him and they would execute his entire family. These guys were not going to fail. There was no amount of money that you could have paid these soldiers that were to guard the tomb to abandon their post and leave. There was no bribe. There was no threat. Because not only are they fighting for their own lives, they're fighting for the lives of their family. Nothing was going to move these men. However, nothing natural would move these men. Nothing natural would break Caesar's seal. Nothing natural would roll the stone away. Because after the third day, Christ rose again. He broke the seal, showing his authority over Caesar. He moved the rock, saying he is all powerful, and overcame the guards as they were indeed found asleep. They fled. He defeated it all. But perhaps the greatest thing he defeated through his resurrection was death itself. This is not a fairy tale. This is not something that we just tell ourselves to make ourselves feel better. This is truth. This is gospel, which is good news. Because as we said before, if Christ is not raised from the dead, we have no forgiveness of sins. This itself was predicted according to the scriptures in Psalm 16:10. Peter references this himself. Psalm 16:10, he references it in Acts 2. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, which was their version of hell, or let your Holy One see corruption. Christ was not corrupted. Christ did not remain dead. He was raised again. And now you might ask, well, Branham, what's more proof that he rose again from the dead, other than he's not there anymore? What's the proof? 1 Corinthians 15, 5-8, of first importance, what I passed on to you, according to Paul, says this, verse 5-8. And that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, and then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep, they died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. In other words, this resurrection, the truth of it, the glorified, risen Christ, was witnessed by over 500 people. Let me remind you of this. To confess Christ, at this point especially, when Paul is writing this in the 60s, would have been a crime punishable by death, as they began to quickly persecute Christians, as Paul did himself, as he will confess. It was a great sorrow he carried. To confess this meant certain death, and at very least being an outcast in that society. Going against the traditional Judaism of the day, going against Caesar. And now you have 500 people that are now willing to say it happened, to say that they saw him, to say that they touched him. 1 John 1-3 says this, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life, Jesus Christ, the life was made manifest. It was right in front of us. We have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. In other words, John, now writing this book, 1 John, in the 90s, even heavier persecution, is saying this, we have seen it, we testify it, I touched him, we touched him, we saw him with our own eyes, we saw him raised from the dead. It wouldn't make any sense for these men to tell this lie and then go on and be tortured and killed for a false belief, for something that they truly did not see. The amount of pain and torture that all these men went through, all these apostles and disciples, we know all 12 or 11 out of the 12 died horrible deaths except John. They're all martyred for their belief, their faith in the Lord Jesus. They were told to deny the resurrection. But they said, absolutely not. So that's how we know he was raised. We know he was raised because we have people who saw it. We have it recorded in history, as this book is not only the Word of God, but it's history. It's useful for all things. But now you might ask yourself, okay, I see the point. I see that it's recorded. We see we have witnesses that confess it. We have those who believe in it, who are willing to die for the testimony of a risen Savior. Why is this important? How does this affect me? So what? Why is it important that Christ was raised from the dead? Well, the Corinthian believers were asking the same question. In fact, they were questioning the resurrection themselves, which is why Paul tells them there was over 500 witnesses that were still alive when he was writing it. He tells them why it's important. Because we believe in a second coming. We believe in a resurrection of the dead, where we will be given new bodies. He says this in 1 Corinthians 15:12-19. Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. In other words, Paul is saying, if Christ did not raise from the dead, then everything we have done, all the preaching he had done, the faith that the believers have, the faith that we hold, the preaching that we are doing, is all in vain. It's all for naught. And he even says that we're to be pitied. Think about if this was all not true, the life wasted. Think about the repercussions of this, of all the time spent working for God. If Christ is not raised, if we're still dead in our sins, our faith would be futile. Our preaching would be futile. In fact, he's saying we're misrepresenting God, which we know that God is holy. He is a God who is just. And he does not tolerate things being said falsely about him. And so therefore, as we look to this, we preach the cross, we preach truth, and if Christ has not been raised, then we are telling lies about God, which would be a very damnable thing. We are to be most pitied. But above all, if Christ is not raised from the dead, then we're still lost in our trespasses and sins. We are still lost. If we just have the cross and no resurrection, then we have no salvation. And Paul sums up this argument. He gives us a wonderful statement, these three verses about this. 1 Corinthians 15:20-22. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He's saying, it's a good thing this isn't true, because in fact, he has been raised. And he is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, meaning those who have died are now with him, ruling with him. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Just as we talked about before, as one man came death, our forefather Adam, who cursed us all when he sinned against God in that garden. We have Jesus Christ, who was following and trusting God perfectly in the garden and went to Gethsemane and died upon the cross. So just as by one man came death, by one man, the Lord Jesus Christ, we have the resurrection of the dead. And just as in Adam all die and are dead in their sins, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. That is the beauty of the resurrection. That is the beauty of what we have received, of what is of most importance. That is how this affects your life. Now I'd say this. If you've never trusted in this, if you haven't received this as most important, and you're still dead in your sins and trespasses, I'd invite you to come forward after the service and talk with me. We can talk about what it means to trust the Lord Jesus Christ as simply as this. Put your faith in him. Quit looking at yourself. Believe in his death. Believe in his resurrection. Believe he has covered you and covered your sins. You might have been straying. You might be gone away from Christ. You may have made a commitment long ago. Maybe last year. Maybe a few days ago. But perhaps you strayed. Perhaps you need to recommit your life to Christ. Perhaps you need to look to him and look to him again and say, God, I have strayed. I've gone far away. But today marks the day where I'm going to give it all back to you. Maybe it's the time that you get back involved in church. Maybe it's a thing that you only do twice a year, Christmas and Easter. Maybe it's time today where you mark the point. God, I'm going to give my life to you. I'm going to get back involved in church. I'm going to return. Maybe your decision is that not you've already been here, but perhaps your decision is to serve. Say, God, how can you use me in this congregation? How can you use me in this local group of believers? Those who have trusted in Christ together, who are worshiping him and trying to grow in him together. Maybe you have a sin that you need to repent of. Maybe you have something you need to turn from that is keeping you from Christ, that is hurting your relationship with him. Perhaps you sit down and do your devotional time where you read the scriptures, where you pray, and you feel so guilty and so broken that you can't do it. Perhaps it's time to turn from that. Find somebody, confess your sin, but most importantly, confess it to God. But ladies and gentlemen, there's only one reason we can do all these things. And that's because we serve a risen Savior. I'm going to pray. I'm going to invite Claire back up here to sing us a song that celebrates this resurrection and celebrates our life in Christ alone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we praise you. We praise you because it did not end with Friday. We praise you because it ended with the resurrected Christ, who is then ascended and ruling at your right hand. God, we know we cannot do anything without this. We know that if he is not raised from the dead, we are of the people who are to be pitied the most. But God, you defeated death when you rose your son from the dead. God, bring us to repentance. Bring us to salvation. And Lord, let us walk in the power of your Spirit. In the Son's name we pray, our risen Savior. Amen. Thank you all for singing along. Gotta love technology, right? Time to gather together, but as a final act of worship, we're going to go into a time of offering. And I want to remind you that there's a couple ways to give. We're going to have men that are going to come around and pass our plates here in just a minute after I pray. Or you can also text to give, which in your bulletin we have that number there, but that number is 727-291-4600. If you text any dollar amount to that number, it'll give you a form to fill out so you can give as an act of worship. You can also give online at our website, which I'll ask you all to visit anyway, which is fbctarpon.org. There's a button there for that. And I also remind you of this, is that this time of giving, this is not a time where we just give out of obligation or we feel like people are going to judge us if we don't. This is an act purely of worship. And so if this is not a worshipful thing for you, if it's not a time for you to be able to give this to God, if you can't do it as cheerfully, then I'm going to say you're doing it for the wrong reasons. And for those of us who have embraced this, that is truly as an act of worship, then this is a time of true worship for us. And so let me pray, then the men are going to come forward. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just pray over these offerings that we're about to give to you. Lord, we know that we can only do this because we serve a risen Savior. God, it is so amazing that you would include us in your plan, that you would include us in our finances to do your wonderful work, Lord, knowing that you wouldn't need to do it at all because you are sovereign. You can raise people from the dead. You can raise your own son from the dead. You've defeated death. You don't need any of this, but Lord, you choose to operate through it. God, I pray you bless his offerings as they go to assist the ministry we do here in this community, across the street, and around the world. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you all for your offerings. Most of all, thank you for being here today. It was an honor to have all of you. But I pray that you don't leave with just the thoughts of we just showed up for Easter on a Sunday this year. I pray that you leave thinking about the risen Savior, thinking about what that does for your life, thinking about how by putting your faith in Christ and trusting in him and him alone, you can walk in newness of life. As you go today, ponder these things, pray about them. We will be here to pray with you if you need prayer, if you'd like to discuss salvation. Let me pray one last time. Heavenly Father, thank you for being a loving Father who saves us and who raised your Son from the dead. Let this truth affect every aspect of our lives. Let it control us and guide us. God, let us live for you. In your son's name we pray, the risen Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Harvest Festival.